Hey guys, what's up? I'm Connor, aka the Music Fanatic, here coming to you guys with another review. But beforehand, before I make the review, I'm going to be doing something that I am planning on doing on this channel, and I'm going to be doing it right now. Every so often when I make a review, I'm going to be giving you guys a little something in the beginning. I collect vinyls, so every once in a while, I'll be giving you guys a little vinyl update. So, for the last few days, I've gotten 4 vinyls, and so in no particular order, these are the ones that I got. First things first, I got the self-titled album by the Ramones. Never had it on vinyl, thought I should have it. It's one of the best punk albums ever made, if not the, so yeah. Next album that I got, is by the legendary hard rock and heavy metal, mostly hard rock band, Deep Purple, and that is the album Machine Head. Little, secret, this is gonna be my next review after the album that I'm reviewing today. So yeah, got that because I've been getting really into Deep Purple recently, and I thought I should own an album by them, and Machine Head is like the best album by them. I've also listened to In Rock, or Deep Purple In Rock, and Burn by them, and I'm going to continue listening to albums by them. Next album that I got is the, without a doubt, probably the absolute best concept album ever made in history, and that is Tommy by The Who. I absolutely adore this album, and needed to own it on vinyl, so I did. And last but certainly not least, one of the best albums that came out of the 2000s, and one of the albums that actually reissued rock and roll to come into the world, and that is This It by The Strokes. So yeah, those are the vinyls that I got recently. On to the review. I was thinking to myself, what album do I need to review this week? What album sticks out to me that I've been listening to a lot recently? Well, recently, I went down to Lincoln for a band trip thing, because for school and everything, there was a basketball game, I was supposed to be in pep band and all that stuff, and on the way down, it's about 3 hours and 2.5 hours away from where I live in Salsa City, Nebraska, and I thought, what albums should I listen to off my iPod? And one of them is an album that I just listened to almost every single car trip that I've ever gone on in my entire life. It's a good time passer because the album is kind of lengthy, but it's not boring whatsoever. I said that The Strokes' Is This It is one of the best albums of the 2000s, but I can safely say that this album that I'm reviewing today, you can already see in the description, so I should probably not waste any time with that. In my opinion, when it comes to music from the 2000s era, I know it's very controversial and very cliche to say this, but I do mean it when I say that I think Kid A by Radiohead is the best album that ever came out of the 2000s era. From 2000 to 2010, this is the best piece of music that came out in those years. So in saying that highly controversial comment that I just made, how do you review an album that is this good? Well, above all, I can say this. This album, along with two other albums, which are actually down here, two other albums, OK Computer and In Rainbows, are the albums that I like to call in the Radiohead discography the recommendation albums. If you want to get into the band Radiohead and you want to know what they sound like and what's so special about them and why they're one of the greatest bands of all time, Kid A, In Rainbows, and OK Computer, and maybe even The Bends are the three albums that I would suggest that you listen to. In fact, this is the album that actually kind of got me into the band. Well, let me explain. I'm actually kind of lying when I say that. Actually, the album that got me into Radiohead and my favorite album by Radiohead that I'm not reviewing today, but In Rainbows was the album that got me into Radiohead and made me love them and stuff. But the story behind how I first listened to Kid A is actually, it goes a little something like this. Consequence of Sound is a website, a reviewing-based website. They talk about music, movies, and pop culture and all that stuff. Before that, though, on their YouTube channel, if you actually go to their YouTube channel, go to videos, and then go over and put, instead of where it says, like, most popular, or, like, update, or, like, upload date by most recent to first video or something like that, if you change that to the first video they uploaded to the last video they uploaded beforehand, is a channel called The Rocket Out Blog, hosted by this guy, Sammy Jarouche, on there. I used to be a huge, huge fan of the Rocket Out Blog, and I used to watch it literally all the fucking time. And he always talked about the band Radiohead, because if you don't know this about the guy, it's his favorite band of all time, and he thinks they're the greatest band in history. Do I think Radiohead's the greatest band in history? No, they're one of, but I wouldn't say they're the greatest. So this is actually the album that got him into the band, and the story was he was at college, he didn't listen to rock music, and then his friend gave him the album, and then he listened to it and loved rock music and stuff. And after hearing that story and how he got extremely into Radiohead and even got into like rock music and all that stuff, I thought, I should give this album a chance. I should give Radiohead a chance, because I only knew the song Creep beforehand, like before that actually happened. So I've actually been like an avid listener, of Radiohead ever since about the year 2011. And I've pretty much loved all of their work ever since I first listened to them, but I didn't exactly like the band when I first heard it. Here's the story why. At that time, I was listening to bands like Green Day, Blink-182, and other bands that I still love to this day, but I was more of like the pop-punk kid. I was more of like the, for some reason, I went through a nu metal phase. God help us all that I actually got out of that. But I was listening to bands like that, and I wasn't really the whole experimental, artsy, experimental rock type guy. So when I heard this album, I was like, oh, I wonder what it sounds like, and I listened to it, and it's completely electronic. Most of the album is electronic music, ambient music, and it's very artsy. So when I first heard that, I didn't exactly latch onto it. Then I listened to In Rainbows, and I didn't exactly latch onto that to begin with at first either. But after a while, after you actually listen to Radiohead's music after a while, they grow on you so much that you actually see how fucking genius they are. And that was the case with this album, Kid A. Just the over-ambience behind the album and like almost the depressing nature that you can actually tell by just looking at the front cover of this album. Just gonna make a quick comment about this. This is a regular size vinyl right here. It's kind of big. It's like 12 inches across and all that stuff. It's like a foot long all the way across. Why is Kid A so small? Like, if you actually look at this thing, it's pretty damn small. It's like a 7-inch vinyl, I think. I haven't measured it. But yeah, like, it's so small that, like, everything in its right place and Kid A are, like, this first side of this. But yeah, it's a very small album. Anyways, and there's also a specific time period, not time period, a season that I think this album goes perfectly over with, and that is winter. Like, winter, I'm not talking about, like, if you're from, like, California or, like, Texas or Florida, you have no idea what the fuck I'm talking about, but, like, as in, like, go up to, like, the Arctic tundra or go into, like, where I live, Nebraska, and, like, see all, like, the landscape is covered by snow and all that, and like it's like kind of a lonely, depressing nature behind it and everything. And the reason also why I say that is because if you look at the front cover of this album, it almost sets up the entire mood behind the album. The front cover of this album, it's like all these mountains, so it looks like just some regular landscape of a mountain and all that stuff, and it looks all natural. But if you really pay attention to it, like, all the weird angles and all, like, the weird digital, like, computer-made stuff, like, on the bottom, like, there's a fog that's made digitally on a computer over this, and, like, all that stuff, it doesn't look natural, and it kind of almost looks like an apocalyptic type thing. And honestly, after I talk about all the individual tracks and everything, I'm going to explain to you the story that I've put in my head behind this album. So let's not waste any more time talking about the overture of this album. Let's talk about each individual track. There's 10 tracks off this album, and it starts off with the monumental song, Everything in Its Right Place. As I said, I think this album is a recommendation album that you could give to anyone who wants to listen to Radiohead. Reason why I know that is because this song and another song off this album called Tree Fingers, I know, it's an ambient song, but there was a time and a place where I was hanging out with my best friend, Landon Notaboom, who's over on the Connor Landon Show, and we were just talking about music and all that stuff, and he said he didn't really know which bands to listen to, and he said, most times I think that silence is, like, the best thing to listen to rather than listening to music and all that stuff. And I was, like, saying, like, he always talked about, like, ambience and, like overtures of, like, overtures like movies and all that stuff, but like a soft ambience and all that and everything. So I thought, I wonder. So I pulled out my iPod. I was playing it through a boombox thing, and I played the song Tree Fingers, and he thought it was incredible when he first heard it. Then I let him borrow the album Kid A, and he listened to the song Everything in Its Right Place. As soon as the first three chords of the first chords of the song played, he already knew that he was going to love this album. And some people have speculated that the meaning behind this song is maybe about like the universe or something like that, or maybe just like a place in this distant future apocalyptic type thing. thing, where everything is in its right place and everything belongs as it is. Also, the line in the song, "Yesterday I woke up sucking on lemons," that actually comes from the fact that, if you've ever looked at Tom York before, the way that his face looks is very, very weird, if I must say. Like, his left eye is kind of, he kind of has a lazy eye. Any Radiohead fan, can you tell me why that is? But, like, he kind of has that face that makes it look like he's, like, sucking on a lemon all the time. He has, like, that sour look on his face, so that's where that line comes from. But, like, the way that the song starts off, it's complete electronic. It's on an electronic piano, and every once in a while, there's kind of, like, just minimalistic drums in the beginning. And, honestly, I looked up a concert footage video. This is also one of the things that actually got me major into Radiohead. I looked up concert footage of him playing the song, and he played the song by himself behind a piano with their drummer, I forgot his name, in the background just playing on the bass drum and all that stuff. And it's kind of just a mind-blowing performance. Like, the vocal performance he does and, like, the way he is behind, like, the piano and stuff, it's kind of a mind-blowing experience to watch. And it's one of probably one of the best songs I think I've ever heard in my entire life. It's definitely maybe my my favorite or second favorite song off this entire album. And it's a great way to start the album and set the mood that this is not really going to be a happy story, per se. It's going to be a story that you can just lay back and listen to. It's a very laid-back album, but it's not necessarily a happy vibe to it. The next song on the album is called Kid A. Kid A, the title track off of this album, is another very electronic, minimalistic, almost ambient sounding type song. And I know I may be saying something that doesn't really make sense to most people here, but have you ever played the game Minecraft before? The reason why I say that is because if you listen to the music that's on that video, on that game, and you listen to this song, Minecraft music kind of resembles this song in a way. It has just that very almost video game type style sounding way behind it. And even the vocals behind this, the lyrics I cannot pick apart at all because of how robotic they sound. It's supposed to sound, the song is about electronics and about like technology and all that stuff, and how it will actually, I'm pretty sure the song is talking about how it will be our impending doom and all that stuff in the future. And it's a very cool sounding song. I wouldn't say it's my favorite song off the entire album, but it is another great, song off this album. It has just that, has that ambience to it that just makes you just sit down. And most people would listen to this song or listen to the song, "Everything Will Be Alright," "Everything in Its Right Place." I almost said "Everything Will Be Alright" in the end. That's a Weezer album. But "Everything in Its Right Place." And most people would sit down and hear the ambience and just think, oh, it's just an ambient sounding song, it's so boring. But that's not the case with these two songs. They have an ambience to them, but they're so entertainingly sounding, and so they just suck you in when you're listening to them, in my opinion. The next song in the album is called "The National Anthem." No, not Star Spangled Banner. It's a song by Radiohead. Couple of fun facts. First off, the bass line behind this song, the iconic bass line behind the song, was actually made by Tom York when he was about 16 years old. He plays bass on this song, and the working title for this song was actually called "Everyone," but they scrapped it because they already had I think it's because "Everything in Its Right Place" is already a song, so they want people to confuse it with another song that starts with E. Also, the reason why it's called "The National Anthem" is because apparently towards the end of the song, you can hear a little bit of the British National Anthem play. The overall vibe that I get from this song is a very apocalyptic type vibe to it. This song was actually recorded in the year 1999 rather than in 2000 when the album came out, and it was when the whole Y2K thing was coming around, so I think it has that apocalyptic type vibe and like very sporadic type vibe to it, for a good reason. And also it has kind of a jazz feel to it, and the reason why I say it has a jazz feel, I don't mean jazz as in like, oh, jazz, I mean like jazz fusion jazz, which is like very, very disorganized, very sporadic, and has like almost a anxious type feel to it. And that's, throughout the entire song it pretty much has that, and there's even like a saxophone breakdown in the middle of the song, and by saxophone breakdown I mean it's just very, what's the word I'm thinking for here? Very crazy sounding saxophone just like breaking out of nowhere. And like this, the way that the last chord hits this song, it just has that, It just has that weird type vibe to it where it's just like, it feels like something like monumentally like terrible just happened, like a bomb went off or something like that. That's actually part of the storyline of the album that I made for this. But I'll explain later. But yeah, I think that the National Anthem is another phenomenal song off this album and one of the best songs off the entire album. It has that bass line that's going to be stuck in your head for the rest of your entire life. The horn section and the jazz fusion type things in here will make you feel anxious while listening to this song, and this that last chord will just stick with you for the rest of your life and almost make you like have like you almost feel like your heart drop when that hits in the song. Next song on the album is called How to Disappear Completely. I am absolutely not kidding you here when I say that the first time I ever heard this song and fully appreciated it, the song How to Disappear Completely, I had a tear in my eye. Because of the way that the beautiful, just the absolute beautifulness of the way that the song sounds. Like the overall overture that they have behind it with the stringed instruments, the echo effect behind the guitar, the amazing vocals by Tom York. When I fully appreciated this album and I listened to the song How to Disappear Completely, I just had like a tear in my eye for like two different reasons. A, I thought this song absolutely sounded beautiful and was one of the best things I've ever heard. And two, the overall depressing vibe behind the song just really got to me for some reason. In my own opinion, I think that this song is talking about a man who is completely down on his life and he absolutely has nothing going for him, and he just wants to learn how to disappear completely and just get away from the world, and he has to almost like not act as himself, as the first line of the song, that there, that's not me, and then at the later part of the song it says, this isn't happening. It just has like an overall depressing vibe to it that also has a dream type vibe, and I think that actually comes from the real reason why Tom York wrote this song. He had a dream that he was floating through the air, and he was pretty much almost presented as a ghost, and he was flying over like Dublin, Ireland. He was just floating in the air, and the overall vibe that you're supposed to get from this song is a feeling of floating. And honestly, you pretty much get that vibe if it's like late at night, you're laying in your bed and all the lights are off in your room and you're listening to this song. It's almost like the dream is actually happening, but you're not asleep. It's an overall beautiful song and one of my favorites off the entire album. The next song on the album is also one of my favorites off the album. But it's weird. This song is an ambient song, but I think it is just one of the best things I've ever heard in my entire life. That's the thing I'll say about this album. It's one of the best things I've ever heard in my entire life. Not best albums. Yes, best albums. One of the best things I've ever heard in my entire life. And the next song is called Tree Fingers. In the song, How to Disappear Completely, I said that you could listen to the song late at night, lay back in your bed, have your headphones in, and just stare up at the ceiling, and almost feel like you're having like a dream sequence. I completely feel that's the same case for the song Tree Fingers. A lot of people would actually knock this song and like make fun of this song in a way for saying that it has no real point on the album, it's just an instrumental track, I don't want to sit there for almost 4 minutes in here, absolutely nothing but like minimalistic instruments playing, whatever the instrument is on this song. But I will knock down those people anytime that they say this, because this is one of the moments on the album that I actually sit there, listen to it, and I thought that this song should have been longer. I thought that it should have extended to maybe 4.5 or maybe even 5 minutes. Because although nothing happens on this song, it's not boring whatsoever to listen to. It's kind of just a beautiful little ambient song that you could listen to. Like if you're having a bad day and you want to go home, and you just want to go home, or when you get home, all you have to do, in my opinion, is put this on your record player as a vinyl, play it on CD, play it through your headset, and just lay back and relax while listening to the song, and you will feel so much better after listening to it. Fun fact, this song is actually on the original motion picture soundtrack for the movie Memento, which is all Batman fans are going to kill me for this. Christopher Nolan movie. It's one of his first movies. I think it was his debut movie, but apparently another song off this album, I think it was Idiotech or something like that, was supposed to be on that, but they chose Tree Fingers because I guess they felt it would substitute with the movie very good. And actually, that version of the song is longer. It's actually 4 minutes and 47 seconds. This version is like 3 minutes and something seconds. But honestly, I think this song actually kind of acts as a pause in the middle of the album. Like the first four tracks, like the first like part of the album, then there's an intermission, there we go, and then the second part of the album starts very abruptly, with the song Optimistic, and this is my favorite song off the entire album. This is one of the only tracks off the entire album that actually features regular rock instruments like guitar, bass, drums, and there's a keyboard, I think. Well, there's just like effects that are put into the song. It's a Radiohead song, what'd you expect? But I don't know what it was, but this is like, even when I didn't really fully appreciate the album, this is one of the songs off of the album that I actually fully enjoyed and thought was a great song, and it's stuck with me ever since. Pretty much the overall vibe behind the song is exactly what the title says. It's an optimistic vibe. It's, you can try the best you can, the best you can is good enough. It's pretty much, it's almost like acting like talking to a person that doesn't think they're good enough, but then saying like, oh no man, you can just try the best you can and you'll be good enough at whatever you want to set your goals at and everything. Which is weird because when they play it live sometimes, Tom York actually switches the vocals and instead says, the best you can is good enough. No, he says the best you can isn't good enough. Even saying that, the overall vibe behind this song is just an uplifting type vibe. Well, besides like 306 to 316 on this song, that's just plain fucking eerie. But the overall vibe behind this song is just like a cheery type mood, which is weird with an album that overall so far has been very depressing sounding and has been very like, has been very like a down-tuned type sounding album that you'd listen to if you were like depressed and at the last limb of your life or something like that. This is one of those songs that it just kind of has that little optimistic, I know, optimistic type vibe to it where it's just like, hey, the best you can is good enough and try your hardest and stuff. And it's been my favorite song off this album ever since I first listened to it. And oh my god, the instrumentation off of this goddamn song. The vocals on this song are obviously great because it's Radiohead and they've never been bad at doing vocals, but the drums behind the song are very, they're very, like, overture-sounding-ish in a way. They are very minimalistic-sounding, but they have a lot going on to them. Like, they make a lot of, like, sounds in the background to make it sound like the overall track has a lot going on in it, even though it's very minimalistic-sounding. The guitar on here is very, very effect-oriented, and you can barely hear the bass on the song, but it's definitely there. There's a riff, I know, there's a riff on this song that's actually could probably get stuck in your head when you listen to it, and overall, I just think the song is absolutely amazing, and it's probably one of my favorite Radiohead songs of all time. The next song on the album is called In Limbo. This is another ambient type sounding song off of this album. It has the same thing going for it that Optimistic did, where it's actual real instruments playing in the song. And there's like a chord progression that plays when the actual vocals come in. When the first vocals come in, you can't understand what they're saying unless you can. If you can, good for you. But overall, the song, A Limbo, in the name of the song, it's In Limbo. Limbo is actually a religious type thing. It's an area in between heaven and hell. If you're Catholic, then you call it purgatory, but it's pretty much, limbo is like the in-between, where there's like nothing going on. And overall, Tom York has said that this song is talking about when you leave somewhere and then you come back. Like, if you leave for a place for an extended time and then come back, lyrically, I don't really see that in the song, but the overall thing that I think sticks out in this song most of all is the drumming on it, because Phil Selway, the drummer for the band, on this song is just playing this constant drum beat that plays over the song that gives, like, the noise behind the album, because every once in a while there'll just be, like, little pauses in the guitar chords that are playing, and then he'll just be behind the drum set playing on the ride cymbal, the snare, and a few other toms on the drum and everything, and the best part of this song is definitely the drums. The vocals are very good when it has the going somewhere, coming back, maybe that's what it's about. I kind of feel like when it says you're living in a fantasy, and the first part of the song it says I'm on your side, it's maybe talking about a guy that is saying something that sounds absolutely crazy, and some guy who thinks that something's going to happen good in his life, but he's just living in a fantasy, and he should probably, you know, just settle with his life and everything. So it's one of the songs that whenever I hear it, it's one of those songs that I had to listen to before I actually talked about it. So it's maybe not one of the most memorable songs off the album, but it is probably, I wouldn't even say it's one of the best songs off the album. It is an amazing, phenomenal song like the rest of this album, because this album's a masterpiece. But it's one of those songs that kind of just like doesn't really stick out as much. The next song on the album is probably the most best-known song off this entire album. It's called Idiotech, or Idiotic. I'm going with Idiotech. This song is complete electronic. And actually, it's not electronic dance music song. It's not an EDM song. It's an IDM song. Intelligent dance music. Intelligent dance music is pretty much, it feels like the beat and like the overall vibe behind the song has a mind of its own, and it's kind of going off what it wants to go off rather than what you would think it would go off. And also, if you listen to IDM music, there's nothing really that you would dance to behind it. It kind of seems like the beat behind the song takes over you and makes you dance to it rather than you dancing and the music going with you. But overall, I think the vibe behind this song is like the presentation of a madman talking, because the first line of the song, Ice Age coming, like women and children first, who's in the bunker and all that stuff, it kind of sounds like maybe like my overall story that I'm going to be talking about later on this album kind of has to go with it, but it sounds like the message of like a madman talking to a group of people and just shouting out these obscenities and things that don't make sense, and it overall just has the very almost unpleasant type vibe. It has like the very madman like insanity type vibe behind the song with there's instrumentation, kind of, every once in a while. There's, like, guitar sounds behind the song, but it has a very electronic feel and very, like, mind-of-its-own type thing. And it's probably one of my favorite, if not my absolute favorite song by Radiohead that I've ever actually heard before. And it's just a phenomenal song, and I actually love the song Idiotech. By the way, Idiotech is not actually a word. It's the misspelling of the word idiotic. So maybe that actually goes with the overall vibe behind the song of me talking about a guy who's a madman. A guy who's idiotic or an idiotech. Next song on the album is called Morning Bell. This song kind of carries off from where Idiotech left off, and it has the last chord of the song Idiotech playing, and then it has Phil Selway doing a instantly recognizable drum beat behind the song, like that. Kind of sounds like that. But Tom York said when they were playing the song in 2009 that the song is talking about when you forget who you are, and then you wake up one day, realize who you were, and then you look at yourself in the mirror, and you remember everything, and then you freak out about it. My own interpretation of the song is that it kind of sounds like someone who's lost all hope in their life, that, or it sounds like a couple who's divorced, because when you actually listen to the song, part of the song it says you can have the furniture, and then it says cut the kids in half, and then clothes on the lawn, it sounds like two people that are discussing a divorce with each other. That, or it sounds like a man that is losing all sanity or losing all hope in his life. I'm gonna go with my interpretation on the insanity man type thing, because it kind of carries on for where Idiotech plays off of. And yeah, overall, I think this is a great track. It's one of those tracks, this entire album, sometimes the songs just beg for like a crescendo, but none of them really get that. But honestly, if there was a crescendo in any of these songs, I'm pretty sure it wouldn't be as monumental as you'd think it would be. And yeah, so that's the song Morning Bell. Last song on the album is called Motion Picture Soundtrack. This is an ambient type sounding song that has a very depressing vibe to it. Now, this is an ambient sounding song, as I said. It has just a few chords playing on an electric piano, and then part of the song there's a harp that come in. And the overall message behind the song, most people have interpreted it as it has suicidal overtones to it, but Tom York or Colin Greenwood or someone in the band actually said in an interview one time that no, Motion Picture Soundtrack is not about a man who's committing suicide. The part of the song it says it's saying goodbye to someone, so it could just be saying goodbye to someone who's dying. It doesn't have to be suicidal. So taking that into consideration, I think that the song is actually a song about a man who's on the brink of death, and the last chord of the song, or the last sounds of the song, which is like the angelic sounds of like the harp going off, is his descent of death into heaven, is my interpretation of the last part of the song. Even though I'm not religious, I can still make religious vibes behind songs. But yeah, so I think it's a perfect way to end the album. Also, the song is about over 3 minutes long, but the last part of the album actually extends about 7 minutes, and then it ends with another kind of Tree Fingers sounding song. The name of the track is beyond me right now, but it actually ends in an ambient sounding song, so that's pretty cool. And yeah, overall, I think this album is absolutely amazing. Now I'm going to explain to you my interpretation of the story behind this album. So after listening to an album that really has different meanings behind every single track, sometimes people like to put their own stories into it. That's the case with me. After listening to this album and hearing that it was recorded in 1999 when the whole Y2K thing was going on, and actually the guys from Radiohead were kind of fearing that Y2K was going to happen, and that the whole apocalyptic type vibe behind the album, even the front cover of the album, here's my interpretation of the story behind Kid A. I think it starts off with everything in its right place, and it's talking about this futuristic type town where everyone has to do what they're told, and everything's in its right place, and nothing is going wrong, and everything is going just fine. Kid A comes in, and the song is about technology, so I think the song is about a scientist who created this overall race of robots, or like a robot type thing that's the fear of, like, and the song is talking about the fear of technology taking over and all that stuff, and it's going to be our doom. And that's pretty much what I think the storyline of the song is talking about, like the robots have been like taking over and all that stuff, or like this new invention called Kid A comes in, and it's like a futuristic type robot race and everything. Then the song National Anthem comes in. Now, I think an overall war breaks off in this song because of, like, this sporadic and insane type way that the song sounds. It just kind of sounds like a song that would be going on, like I said, the last part of the song sounds like a bomb or something like that would go off. That's actually how I interpret it. I think that at the end of the song, the last chords or so on the the instruments on, like, the horns and all that stuff, I think that, like, a nuclear bomb or something like that, like, exploded and, like, killed everyone and all that stuff. And then it goes into the song, How to Disappear Completely, and I interpret that as the last man to ever survive that, and the only guy to survive that has woken up, and, like, the overall beginning of the song and everything kind of sounds like to me the man has woken up and he's looking across this whole nuclear landscape of nothingness, almost this Fallout type looking thing. It's all dark, it's all clouded over, it's all dark and everything, and I take that from, like, the front cover of this album, which is all dark and everything, just has, you know, the mountains and all that stuff on there, and it's pretty much just him being depressed that everything that has been surrounded him is just taken off by this giant explosion. The song Tree Fingers is, I think, him is, like, pretty much the pause in him settling himself and him thinking that he should go off and he should venture out and try to find something else. The song Optimistic is, like, him talking to himself, saying that the best you can is good enough. You need to go off and need to find all this stuff, and everything needs to be as it is, and everything you need to do this. Then the song in Limbo is talking about a person, maybe he actually found someone else, and they're cutting him down and saying, like, oh no, you're stupid for thinking this, you can't do that, this is bad, and everything. And that drives him crazy into the song Idiotech, when he actually finds, like, a town and all that stuff, maybe, or he finds a bunch of people, and he's talking about this, like, apocalypse thing and everything, like, everything's, you know, the world's ending, like, all this bad stuff is happening, everything. And the song Morning Bell is, I think, like, they locked him up maybe in an insane asylum, or them saying, doing all that stuff where they put him, like, in somewhere and they shoot him down, and he's pretty much at the last limp of his life and everything, and maybe he, like, starves himself and everything, and it just ends all bad. And then the song Motion Picture Soundtrack is when he actually finally dies, he's slowly dying by himself in this nuclear wasteland of nothingness, and the last part of the song, it's like his soul ascending out of him, going into heaven and all that stuff. So I think my interpretation of the story behind this album is very, very depressing, but it works very well for the overall vibe and story behind the album and the way that the songs sound and everything. So it has a futuristic type vibe to it, and I think that's what Radiohead was going for. Ever since the first time I've listened to this album, ever since I first appreciated this album, I think this is one of the best albums and one of the best overall things that exist in this universe that I have ever heard in my entire life. This album gets an overall 10 out of 10 out of me. It's a phenomenal album, the best album of the 2000s in general, one of the best albums of all time. It will go down in history. People will be talking about this album in the year 2040 and talking about how great this album was and how such a moment. Like, this album is not just an album. This album is a moment in fucking time. Like, it's 50 minutes long, But as Colin Greenwood said when he made the song Tree Fingers, he wanted to make an album that didn't feel too long and didn't feel too boring. So the overall, this album is 50 minutes long, and it should be 50 minutes long, and it needs to be 50 minutes long. And this album is absolutely incredible. If you have not listened to it, you definitely should. And that is pretty much it. I give this album a 10 out of 10. Never mind, before that, I need to talk about my favorite tracks off the album. So, there's 10 tracks off this album. If I were to cut that in half, that is 5. So, half of 10 is 5. So, my 5 favorite songs that I enjoy the most off this album in no particular order would be Everything in Its Right Place, The National Anthem, Tree Fingers, Optimistic, and Idiotech. So, those are the 5 songs that I enjoy the most off this album. What are your top 5 favorite songs off of this album? Let me know in the comments below, and yeah. So that is pretty much it for my review for Kid A by Radiohead. If you have listened to this album and you like this album or you dislike this album or you think the album's okay, let me know why in the comments. And yeah, so that's pretty much it. If you enjoyed this video, hit that like button. In the comment section below, leave me suggestions for albums I should review next, even though the next album I'm reviewing is going to be the album, as I said at the beginning of the video, Machine Head by Deep Purple. It's a 7-track album, so it shouldn't be that hard. And it's a classic album. So yeah, that's pretty much it. 3, 2, 1, I'm done. And subscribe.